Welcome to worship on this Reformation Sunday, and so glad to have all of you here for this festival worship. For those online, I hope you've found the bulletin. It was late getting published, but it should be up on the website now. With that, let's stand and join in our gathering song. Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let's join in the prayer of the day. Let us pray. Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in times of trial. Defend them against all enemies of the gospel. And bestow on the church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our reading this morning comes from the first book of Kings, beginning in the fifth chapter. Now King Hiram of Tyre sent his servants to Solomon when he heard that they had anointed him king in place of his father. For Hiram had always been a friend to David. Solomon sent word to Hiram saying, "You know that my father David could not build a house for the name of the Lord his God because of the warfare with which his enemies surrounded him, until the Lord put them under the soles of his feet. But now the Lord my God has given me rest on every side. There is neither adversary nor misfortune. So I intend to build a house for the name of the Lord my God. For as the Lord said to my father David, your son, whom I will set on your throne in your place, shall build the house for my name." Several chapters later, then Solomon assembled the elders of Israel and all the heads of the tribes, the leaders of the ancestral houses of the Israelites, before King Solomon in Jerusalem to bring up the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord out of the city of David, which is Zion. All the people of Israel assembled to King Solomon at the festival in the month of Ethanim, which is the seventh month. And all the elders of Israel came, and the priests carried the ark. So they brought up the ark of the Lord, the tent of the meeting, and all the holy vessels that were in the tent. The priests and with the Levites, they brought them up. King Solomon and all the congregation of Israel who had assembled before him were with him before the ark, sacrificing so many sheep and oxen that they could not be counted or numbered.
So have you ever wondered about names? You know, sometimes maybe you're at a restaurant and you don't remember the server's name, so maybe you just think of a generic name like Jack. You know, you call that out. Have you ever done that? No. Jack is a great name, generic name. You know, yeah, it's very famous. You've heard of the restaurant chain, Jack in the Box?
No.
You've never heard of it?
Yes, I have.
Have you ever eaten there?
No.
We'll talk to your parents about that. But yeah, Jack and the Beanstalk, right? Famous novel. And today is Reformation Sunday, right? It's also Confirmation Sunday at the 11 o'clock service. And what else is today?
Halloween.
Halloween, yeah. And kind of a fun holiday, right? I always wonder, kind of struggle with what's too much to wear as a decoration and what isn't. And so I came up with this necklace. It's kind of a kitchen quilt Audrey Fisher gave. So if we think about the jack-o'-lantern, have you carved pumpkins? Yeah? You know, years and years ago, the story is that people carved these pumpkins to scare off evil spirits, and they put a candle or lit coal or embers inside. And anyways, that's one story about where it came from. But why would they call the pumpkin Jack?
Because the name is super popular.
Super popular? And you said it was a great name?
Yeah.
What did you say?
They didn't have any other options.
They didn't have any other options. Well, you know, so the story goes that perhaps the watchman, the evening watchman, would carry a lantern, and they didn't always know the person's name carrying it, so they just called them Jack. Jack with the lantern, or Jack-o'-lantern. That sounds pretty good, I think. So we'll go with that. But it lights up the way, right? When you go up to the steps to the front door, knock on the door, the lantern, the jack-o'-lantern lights the way. No, but when you come to the entryway, usually there's jack-o'-lanterns there to light the entryway, so you see the steps. Yeah, but they usually turn them off on Halloween. Work with me, Noah, work with me. So, how does this tie in with today's lesson? I bring you tape, packaging tape. The children of Israel, the Israelites, moved into a new temple. That's what our reading is about today. Solomon built the temple. His father David wasn't meant to do that. And there was a lot of fanfare, and it was a huge celebration as they dedicated the temple. And I think of this space, I think of this sanctuary where people hopefully feel safe to come, where all are welcome, as our hymn talked about. And can you imagine what it would be like to open that temple with all the majesty and too many animals to offer for sacrifices that they couldn't count them, and all the dignitaries that were there? And that temple was like a shining light in the Israelites' life. And for many people, this congregation is a light as well. So that's kind of our connection. We have jack-o'-lanterns for a fun holiday called Halloween that kind of light the path as we come to the doorway. And we are a part of a congregation that is a light in this community. And we carry that light of Christ as our acolytes at the end of the service carry the light of Christ into the world. So we carry that light, that love of Christ. Yes?
I know why it's called Halloween.
Why?
Because there's hall and holiday, Because Halloween is a holiday.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Very good. Well, let's close with a prayer. Can you join me? Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your love and for your care. Help us to be lights in your world, to cast out the darkness and the sadness, but to bring your love, peace, and joy to all people. Be with us this week in all that we say and do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So join me in back. I have a treat for you.
Well, grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So we continue this story of Israel. And just to kind of recap, this whole fall we've been kind of looking at people's call stories in a way, right? How did people come into the service of God? And all of the heroes, or if you want to use that term, that we've been talking about, were somehow anointed or called by God. So Samuel was called in the middle of the night. David was anointed with oil in some way. Solomon, we're told, really has no quote-unquote call story. He is just anointed by the people to be king. And it's not until he's praying that God comes to him. And in that prayer, after he's been made king, God asks him what? What do you ask of me? And Solomon says, I want to be a wise ruler. I want wisdom to lead my people. And so God grants him that wisdom. Now, that wisdom helps him out a little bit, but just like every human in Scripture, he falls short of the glory of God. But one of the major pieces of the story of Israel is the temple. We can talk about the creation story, the Exodus, and the making of the temple as three of the main stories of Israel that they use often, either as pure metaphor or as a sign that they are a chosen people. Now, what's interesting, of course, is in this story, you have to wonder what it was like to move from one way of worshiping, one way of encountering God, that is, in a tabernacle or a tent that was movable, mobile, temporary, to this huge stone permanent structure. And I'm sure the people argued about the color of the rug then, just as they do now. No, seriously, I wonder if there wasn't people who said, wait a minute, no. No, we want to worship the old way. That's how our ancestors worshiped. That's how everybody else worshiped that came before us. Why would we change? Yet Solomon, following David's desire, wants to build a temple for God. And goodness sake, Solomon's going to bless it. He's going to throw the biggest party ever to remind people of the glory of God. And when you entered that space, we're told, you felt the presence. It was magnificent. And so the people transition from worshiping out in the wilderness to worshiping now in the city. They transition from worshiping in a tent to worshiping inside this cathedral, if you will. A big change. Now, Martin Luther, as we know, was sort of the instigator of another big change. The church had worshiped in a certain way for a long time, in a particular language. And one of the major changes he makes is we need to give the word of God in people's own tongue. We must now bring the word to the people. As Luther is said to have said, we cannot keep the word in the cathedrals anymore. It needs to be out in the street. And I'm sure there is people, we do know that there was people saying, no, we can't change. We can't change. We've always done it this way. And then I'm sure there's people that loved it and embraced it. But change did indeed happen. So it seems, just in these two stories, that the church or the people or the chosen ones and how they are in the world changes. It moves. It's not always the same. We went from only gathering in this space to not gathering in this space at all. And we had to worship in a new way. It was a mini reformation, if you will. It taught us things about who we are and how we can be the people. Whether we're gathered here or gathered out there, we are still the people of God. There's a lot of anxiety in the church. There's a lot of anxiety in the world. There's a lot of anxiety in our homes because the world just doesn't seem like it was. I don't know about you, but I felt like I kind of had life figured out pre-pandemic. Not so much now. Just like any change in moving from one way to another, I feel like I'm in limbo. I'm still trying to figure it out. I feel like things are kind of spinning and I'm trying to figure out what I'm seeing. We seem to be in the midst of a big change about how the church was to how the church is going to be. And this Reformation, if you will, has captured us. The church used to be, as I hear from a lot of you, a place where I could go and I knew what to expect. Because out there is just crazy. But now, even when I come to worship, I hear, I don't know what to expect. For you out there, you never know if the sound's going to work or not. For us in here, who's going to be here? Am I going to see my friends? And if I don't see them, what's our immediate thought? I hope they're okay. A lot of anxiety. But there is a constant, isn't there? This promise of God that I will be with you always. This promise of God, no matter where you're come from and where you're going, I will be on that journey with you. The good news is that Jesus reminds us of the gift of this Holy Spirit that is with us and that maybe this is a time for us to be quiet and to listen and discover where the Holy Spirit might be leading us. And it is frustrating because things are changing. And how do we hang on to what we thought was important to us as it's slipping away? What new must we grab onto? Or better yet, can we do what we are supposed to have done all along? And put our trust in the Lord. The Lord, who is our strength and who is our refuge. Amen. I invite you to stand and we'll join in our hymn of the day, Built on a Rock.
Thank you.
friends, we give thanks for the gift of baptism and for Isabella Curcio, Bjorn Shansby, Jackie Fairbanks, Thomas Holmes, one with us in the body of Christ.
I present to you, I'll turn on my mic. I present to you Isabella, Jackie, Thomas, and Bjorn. And they desire to make public affirmation of their baptism.
Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you for these siblings in faith, whom you have made your own by water and the word in baptism. You have called them to yourself. Enlighten them with the gifts of your Spirit and nourish them in the community of faith. Uphold your servants in the gifts and promises of baptism and unite the hearts of all whom you have brought to new birth. We ask this in the name of Christ.
Amen.
Now I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. And at this time, I invite the congregation, as they are able, to stand and confess your faith alongside these young people. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw you from God? Do you believe in God the Father? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? Do you believe in the God, the Holy Spirit? Amen. You may be seated. You have made public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in holy baptism? To live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. How do you answer, Bjorn?
I do and I ask God.
Thomas?
I do and I ask God to help me.
Jackie?
I do and I ask God to help
me. And Isabella? People of God, do you promise to support Isabella, Bjorn, Jackie, and Thomas and pray for them in their life in Christ?
We do.
At this time, I would like to invite the parents to come forward. Mom's coming, don't worry. There we go. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give us new birth, cleanse us from sin, and raise us to eternal life. I ask you to lay hands on your sister. There you go. Stir up in Isabella the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen.
Isabella,
you chose your favorite Bible verse from Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
Now stir up in Jackie the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen.
Jackie Fairbanks, you selected your Bible verse today from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 8. This is the first year where two confirmands have selected the same verses. Here is Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 through 8. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace.
Stir up in Thomas the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen.
Thomas Holmes, you selected your verse to be Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to go on to the heights.
Now stir up in Bjorn the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. I take it you heard this reading from before. Now we return to the bulletin. Let us rejoice with Isabella, Bjorn, Jackie, and Thomas, our siblings in Christ. We rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we will give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world. I invite you to turn around and receive the acclaim of your congregation. Woohoo! Yay! Set free from sin and death and nourished by the word of truth, we join in prayer for all of God's creation. We pray for all who long for a word of truth and for the radical grace that flows from the cross. Inspire congregations to freely and boldly proclaim your love for all people with persistence and hope. Hear us, O God. We pray for your creation, for mountains, rivers, streams, cities, homesteads, and neighborhoods. Write in our hearts a new love and care for creation. Give us the will to curb wasteful habits and to hold accountable those who neglect the vulnerable. Hear us, O God. We pray for all who aspire to public office and for all who will vote on Tuesday at our local polling places or here in Washington through the mail. Pour wisdom and understanding upon all who govern so that communities of justice and peace may thrive. Hear us, O God. We pray for all who long for healing in mind, body, or spirit, especially Connie and Jet. Strengthen hospitals, clinics, counseling centers, nursing homes, and recovery centers to be holy spaces of renewal, that all might live the abundant life you intend. Hear us, O God. We pray for all who seek to grow in faith and love of you. Guide teaching and learning and confirmation, small groups, Sunday school, youth groups, schools, seminaries, and universities. We lift up this day our confirmands, Isabella, Bjorn, Thomas, and Jackie, who will be confirmed this day. Hear us, O God. For whom do the people pray? We give thanks for all the saints and reformers who have gone before us, who dwell in your holy habitation, especially Bob Waters and Misty Flying Cloud. Give us courage through their example to challenge unjust systems and work toward life-giving reformation. Hear us, O God. Confident that you hear us, O God, we boldly place our prayers into your hands. Through Jesus Christ, our truth and life. Let us now confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our comforter. Like lost sheep, we have gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth with our apathy and greed. Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you all. Let's share that peace with one another. At this time, we usually receive our offering, but we'll ask that you, if you brought offering, to place it in the offering plate by the baptismal font on your way forward for Holy Communion. If you want to give online, you can go to flcbothell.org and click on the donate button. Let's join now in our offertory hymn.
Oh,
invite you to stand and join with me in the offering prayer. Let us pray. God of abundance, you cause streams to break forth in the desert and manna to rain from the heavens. Accept the gifts you have first given us. Unite them with the offering of our lives to nourish the world you love so dearly. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy God, our bread of life, our table and our food, you created a world in which all might be satisfied by your abundance. You dined with Abraham and Sarah, promising them life, and fed your people Israel with manna from heaven. You sent your son to eat with sinners and to become food for the world. Those online and those here in the sanctuary, please join with me in the words of institution. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his life given for us and his rising from the grave, we await his coming again to share with us the everlasting feast. By your Spirit, nurture and sustain us with this meal. Strengthen us to serve all in hunger and want. And by this bread and cup, make of us the body of your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. All who hunger and thirst, come, the table is ready. You may be seated as I invite our servers to come forward. Please know we do serve bread, but if you need gluten-free, just let me know and I will offer that to you. We serve red wine and white grape juice.
Thank you.
Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. Lord of life, in the gift of your body and blood, you turn the crumbs of our faith into a feast of salvation. Send us forth into the world with shouts of joy, bearing witness to the abundance of your love in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Good morning. As was mentioned in the children's message, today we celebrate confirmation at the 11 a.m. service. There are four ninth grade students who will be confirmed, and they are Isabella Curcio, Jackie Fairbanks, Thomas Holmes, and Bjorn Shonsby. So we wish them well on their spiritual journey. 1 week from today, following the second service from 12:15 to 3, we'll be assembling college care packages for about 15 students who are studying, and we look forward to having our middle school and high school students help with that. So if you're able to help, please sign up on the youth board, and there'll be a pizza lunch during that assembly time. Today is the last day as we collect items for Compass Housing Alliance for the homeless, socks and toiletries. Actually, we're going to extend that through tomorrow. So if you were unable to bring items today, please bring them tomorrow, because Tuesday they will be delivered. So thank you for your support. Very much appreciated. And we'll get some numbers to share with you next Sunday as to the totals. And Journey class is coming up in 2 weeks, being put on by the Education Committee and members of the Church Council. It's called Living Stones Project, and it's in regards to our affirmation of faith, how we each believe in our faith and share it. And it should be a very interesting class, so please stay tuned. So that will be on Sunday, November 14th at 3 p.m. Thank you.
Hopefully you all received in your email or in the mail your pledge card for 2022. As of today, we had 15 people pledge of the usual 80 that we receive. So please look in your email and fill that out. It's a Google form, and then so we can make plans for 2022. For adult ed today, we are continuing our study of immigration, and if you haven't attended a class yet, you're still welcome to come down. We're going to start looking at a book called They Are Us, and describing how our work as Lutherans in the immigration world is done. With that, let's stand and receive our blessing. People of God, you are Christ's body, bringing new life to a suffering world. The Holy Trinity, one God, bless you now and forever. Let's turn the page and we'll join in our sending song. Thank you. peace, the living word, dwells in you.